with their new single, Hourglass. Welcome, Squeeze! Sit next to me, Jools.
Thank you.
Good to see Squeeze back.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, I mean, you've rejoined them, as it were.
Well, we have been together now for a couple of years. We in fact, we appeared on this very show when our last album came out.
That's right.
And that was an enormous flop. So
was it?
We've decided to reappear.
On this show is the kiss of death.
Yes, I know.
You're extremely plucky to agree to appear on it again.
Well, we find it's the remedy for success. They chose me. I thought it would be best that I talk rather than anybody else, because the others have an unfortunate habit of having inadvertent foul-mouthed slips of the tongue, so I thought it would be far safer to have I.
And nothing is further from you, is it? I mean, for goodness sake. When I saw that, I couldn't... It wasn't you.
It was an inadvertent slip of the tongue, an imposter, and if I can find him, I'd certainly have a few words to say to him, let me tell you.
Careful of what you have to say to him.
Yes.
What would you say to him? Get away, or...
Yes. Be off with you.
Be off with you.
Lord Lummy, Lord Rubber Duck, I say to him.
Ah, that's a good one too. The old Victorian curse.
Yes.
Yeah. So, which do you prefer, the old TV presenting or working with the band? I bet it's the band, isn't it?
Well, yes, the band's really good fun. You see, and we tour a lot, and we tour. We just did some shows with David Bowie in America in huge stadiums.
Does he call himself Bowie or Bowie?
Bowie. Although I did come across an American man who said, "I hear you're doing some shows with David Bowie." And they call it a bowie.
Well, it's a bowie knife, you know.
Yes, that's what they say. But over there, it really is quite extraordinary because you wander out on stage, and I don't think if you were at the back, David would have just been a mere little speck floating around, you know.
It's tough on them. Now, the thing is that the Squeeze, popular enough, God knows, here, but you're very, very popular in America.
Yes.
And that, so you're there for backing a very big show like Bowie's. But as you say, isn't it? It's a bit hard on people who pay an awful lot of money. And the same thing with like Madonna's here now. She's going to be a huge concert. And for many people who pay a lot of money, she'll be about this size on the stage. They won't even see her expression, will they? It's all different from a football match because you're watching the ball, but if you're looking for a personality and they're about that size.
I think people go for the event as well. I think that's what they have when you have thousands of people all in a thing together. Although I did hear a quote which I thought was quite interesting from Phil Spector's wife, whose name is Ronnie, I believe. And she said that she liked playing in
you know everything, Ronnie Spector.
Yes, you say, a mine of musical information.
Goodness me.
And she said she found that playing in big stadiums, when she played in a big stadium, she only felt happiest if she felt as though she made love to everybody in the audience. And I think Squeeze like to take the same approach. I think we have here tonight, haven't we? Yes.
Yes, I wondered, they were a little suspiciously quiet at the beginning. Perhaps they felt that you weren't going to carry through your threat to make love to all of them.
Yes, not literally, you understand, just metaphorically speaking.
Oh, it's not going to be literally?
No.
Oh, not a figure.
No,
oh.
No, we leave that entirely to you.
Oh, well, fine. Don't go away, then we're both in the door. Now, I mean, you're a mean pianist. My sons are great fans of your pianistic ability.
Oh.
No, right. But you're kind of self-taught, aren't you?
Well, no, I had an uncle, in fact, Uncle David, if you're out there, Uncle David.
Hi, Uncle Dave.
Who had a very interesting story. He must have been Uncle David X, because he taught me to play the sort of boogie-woogie piano when I was small. And then later, he unfortunately lost the end of this finger in an accident. And then I had to write to the insurance company saying that he had taught me to play the piano, and he was now completely useless as a teacher because he had lost the end of his finger. And he got a new Range Rover or something, and he was all happy, and everybody was happy. Obviously, I can't go into too many details, or the fraud squad will be probably waiting for me outside.
I think you've given Dave Allen some ideas, I'll tell you.
It wasn't him.
Oh, wasn't it?
No.
It seems to be missing in most David's slides, the finger. Yeah. Now, you've produced a video with this, haven't you, which is, people tell me is wonderful. We'd prefer to have to see you and do the thing live. Why do you think it's all relying on videos now, isn't it? We've got MTV opening up here. Is that going to replace radio?
I don't think it'll ever replace radio, but I think videos can be a lot more telling about what groups are like. I mean, for instance, this programme is about Elvis, and Elvis made lots of films, so people felt they got to know him a lot better. And I think in a video you can see, especially if a band used a lot of cliché type of images in their video, it can tell you a lot more about the band than just listening to their record. But the other thing is, of course, when MTV comes here, the other danger is that you just get constantly the same sort of thing, and you don't get variations, and you don't hear of older records, or it's just constantly
but
the latest.
That's been the recipe for the success in the States, hasn't it?
Yes.
And you think it'll happen here?
I'm sure it'll be very successful here. Although the thing is, people don't watch it. I mean, that's like presumably people who sit down and watch Wogan will actually tune in and watch what's going on, whereas when MTV is on, it's just a thing that's merely a backdrop, like having a sort of a gas bar or something, and people sit around it. And they have it on in bars and stuff in the States, and it's just a thing that's sort of.
But it has succeeded. Now, you're going to do a bit of radio, aren't you? You're going to sit in for Andy Kershaw?
Just for 2 weeks, yes. And in fact, a man from one of the tabloid papers rang me and said, because they always want some interesting angle,
of course, yes.
You know, and it was, well, what are you going to be, you're going to be swearing on the radio then? And I said, no, but it'll be a radio programme that you'll be able to swear by. And it just went in and out, one out, one out, the other. And I thought it would have been a nice headline, you know.
Yeah.
Foul mouth gets speaks out on wireless, but we're just going to be live, some live music. It's not really a big thing we're going to do, just a couple of weeks on a Sunday lunchtime. Well, perhaps you'd like to come on.
Your modesty is engaging.
Duh.
And typical. But I don't want you to leave.
I'm looking forward to seeing the Elvis things. Are very interesting.
When you've gone so well so far, I'm loath to let you leave.
I'll stay here then.
The audience are quiet.
I
was hoping that they would applaud you at that point.
Should I stay?
On your button.
But I'll stay there after a moment.
I can sit on my
own. Stay there and then move at the moment she comes in.
It's all tremendously worked out in advance, all this. Well, even as we speak, thousands of Elvis fans are going to Graceland for the King's anniversary. Again, you at home may have seen it in the news. On Sunday, elsewhere, aging rockers by the thousands are dusting off the blue suede shoes and taking their hair down to the garage for an oil change, in readiness for their own Elvis Jamboree. Of course, the man's become a legend, as is the case with all legends, it's hard to know what's fact and what's fiction. And my next guest knows the truth behind at least some of the stories. She's one of the very few British actresses to have known and worked with Elvis as his co-star in Paradise Hawaiian Style back in 1966. We'll roll back the years, remind ourselves of those heady days.
Going somewhere?
Danny thinks he can get along better without me, so let him settle up with Blackman any way he wants to.
And that evens up the score.
That's life, fun and games.
Too bad Danny didn't realize that before he put himself into hock for all this.
That's his problem. I got my own to worry about.
Has there ever been anyone but you, really? I mean, have you ever cared about anything or anybody without thinking what they could do for you?
I tried to explain to him it wasn't my fault, but he wouldn't listen.
I think you're more to blame for what happens to you than you're willing to admit. I think you're bitter and arrogant and just plain selfish.
Oh! Please welcome Susanna Lee. Hard words there, Susanna, hard words.
Since
you did say, did you find in real life, did you find Elvis to be selfish and arrogant when you were working with him?
Not at all. I mean, Elvis was perhaps, as in someone to work with, very professional. I mean, he always knew his words, he was always on time.
Was he really, though? I mean, yes. This is not just a kind of mythology that you subscribe to. That's the kind of person he was.
No, he was.
Conscientious.
Oh, yes. I mean, he was totally different to what I obviously imagined. I thought he would be, Elvis Presley, the big king, you know, he could do anything, say anything. But he did have power. People always say he had no power. I mean...
Well, they always said Colonel Parker had all the power.
Oh, yes, in that respect.
He manipulated him, but not so.
Well, no. I mean, Colonel Parker had the power behind the throne as far as work was concerned. But, I mean, there was a day, for instance, when... I mean, it was terrifying for me. I mean, I went on the set one day, and there was this incredible-looking blonde with long blonde hair, and I was blonde, right? And I went rushing, and I went, Evie, Evie, help, help, quickly! I mean, look, there's this blonde, and I mean, I'm blonde, and I'm, aren't I supposed to be the star? He said, listen, babe, there's no problem, babe. We'll just get her in the worst wig you've ever seen. It'll be black and long, and no problem, baby. I said, really? I mean, incredible. I mean, within minutes, she was in the dodgiest black long wig. And this was an incredible girl.
Yeah.
And so, I looked great next to this poor girl who was in tears with this long black wig.
Did you find Elvis very charming? I mean, working with him, did you fall for his charms?
Well, I mean, luckily, fall for his charms. I mean, you couldn't help it. I mean, he was one of those people that, actors or actresses, and obviously, I mean, we all either photograph incredibly well, and in real life, it's not always the same thing, or the other way around. But with Elvis, it was unbelievable. He photographed so badly. I mean, I'd been brought up with crystal sets and... when I was in the convents and at school and things like that, we used to tune into Radio Luxembourg, listening to Elvis Presley, because there was only one key, it was Elvis Presley. And I used to tell him these stories. And but when I first met him, he walked on the set, and I was looking down or something, and he said, excuse me, ma'am. Because, I mean, he did this ma'am and sir, but mainly because, of course, he used to forget people's names like me. I used to call everybody darling. It was easier because then I wouldn't have any problems for forgetting guys' names.
It wasn't Southern graciousness then. It was just
he arrived with this amazing cup of tea, which I don't drink Indian tea. I drink China tea, lemon and honey. And I looked at it, and I didn't look at him. I just looked at the tea, and I thought it was just somebody, you know, right? Excuse me, ma'am, this is a cup of tea for you. I believe you're English, everybody drinks tea. And I said, oh, yes, but I signed a contract with Paramount and Hal Wallace, and I just made films with Tony Curtis, so I was quite sort of busy thinking I was, you know, bees knees and all that. Nonsense. So I said, oh, yes, but I drink China tea, lemon and honey, didn't you realize? And I looked up, good God, I've never seen anything so amazing. I mean, he's so good looking, this guy. And I went, it's all right, I said. Perhaps I'll drink Indian tea today.
I mean, that is interesting that the camera wasn't kind to him. I always personally felt it, because just the shape of his face was such, and his nose was such. In profile, he looked terrific, but in front face, he was a kind of a puddin'. What, did you see any of the movies?
Yes, puddin', less interesting.
But don't forget,
yes.
You always put £10 on in front of a camera.
Oh,
I know.
Yes, don't, please, Suzanne, there's no need to indulge in personal vituperation. Oh, I'm trying to lose a bit of weight. But, yes. I mean, did you see any of the movies?
Yes, I did. I thought the thing that he did, you see, I thought, a little like myself, he was one of the first sort of white singers to overtly use sex in his the way he sort of put himself across, which, of course, they all do now. Yeah. I mean, and there's lots of people now who still look like... I mean, Nick Kamen, for instance, looks like... It has the same sort of stance as an Elvis Presley type of... When Elvis first... Sure.
But you personally...
I never found him attractive, but I thought he was a great dancer.
Easy for you to say now.
Yes.
Yeah.
All those years later.
Yes. Right.
Yes, with hindsight and everything behind us. Yes. But I thought he was. It was
hindsight
it was,
and everything was, behind us. Yes. That's a good one. I must remember that one.
It was the way he moved. I think really, you know, yeah. And the way he went. He could go hurt. And also, you see, he started the and everybody does it nowadays. They have one hair hanging down and they look all sexy. Steve McGarrett used to have it in Hawaii 5-0.
That's true.
And they all do it now. Duran, you name it, they've got. Even Madonna's probably got a little bit of hair.
What about the stories about his legendary generosity? Did you come across any of that?
Incredible. I mean, Elvis was so generous, it was ridiculous. Luckily, he had so much money because he was so generous. I mean, there used to be...
Well, he'd been bankrupt otherwise.
Well, yes, because he used to, for instance, we'd be chatting and things like this, and in the background there was always a sort of local radio station or something like that, and there'd be the disc jockey. I remember one day the disc jockey said, you know, I'd really like Harley Davidson, and so Elvis said, did you hear that, baby? Damn it, he always called me baby, and I hated it. And I used to say, oh, please, EP, can you just call me something like Suzanne? He said, sure thing, baby. You know, I could. So he said, he rang and pressed the button, right? And sure enough, get a Harley Davidson round to that boy. What was his name on that show? I thought, wow, look at that. I mean, but for fans, I mean, he was something else. He gave me enormous presents. But it was so embarrassing, some of them. But he loved to see your face when he gave you something.
Was he a man of moods? Did he have a bad temper?
Yes, but I mean, of course, I mean, if you're that big, I mean, you know, he never traveled, on tour. I mean, you've been, you know what it's like to be on tour, and he never had to go.
He's got a rotten temper as well.
Yeah. No, be on tour. The Stones went on tour, the Beatles went on tour. I mean, Elvis never could, went on tour. He was too big to go on tour. There was nowhere big enough to hold the people that wanted to see him.
Yes, how true that is. Okay, Suzanne, I want you to stay, because there's somebody I know that you want to meet. I'll stay, if you don't mind sitting beside Jules.
He'll, have a drop of gin.
You don't. Have some gin, yes, please. While you're doing that. Thank you for that.